by Hermann Hauser. So it is the one of the most used processors which is currently in the market. Okay, this is a base processor which will be using in your mobile phones, laptops and desktops. This is the base processor. Okay, for example, if your mobile have a Snapdragon or Exynos or any processor like Bionic processor. So for all these processors, this ARM processor is the base one. Okay, so we are going to study about it now. And early architectures of ARM processor is V1, V2, V3, like that we have series of ARM architectures. Okay, so in this base of the architecture is transistor. So we have n number of transistors in each architecture. That transistors plays a major role. Okay, so in the early architecture, we'll be having a huger area. So like we'll be having heavy area and it occupies heavy modules in it. So see, in this V1 architecture, we'll be having fewer than 25,000 transistors. Just imagine how to place a 25,000 transistors in a module. So it looks big, right? So in current processor, don't have that kind of things, okay? All these modules were occupied in a single processor. And again, in V2, we'll be having 30,000 transistors, and like that, it goes on increasing. And here we see a new word, V3, 32-bit addressing. So what is this addressing? Is instruction. We'll be giving instructions to the processor, what operation it should do. Okay, so we are giving it to 32-bit addressing, and now it just expanded to 128, 512, so like that, etc. Okay. Do you guys have a subject on computer architecture? Please do respond. Do you have subject like computer architecture? Hello? If you respond, I can talk there. Hello? Anyone?
No, ma'am.
You can call me Veda, not ma'am, okay? Okay, fine. So in that, if you have that subject computer architecture, you will be briefly studying about instruction sets, this addressing modes. Okay, now we are not in need of that. So I'm just telling it a short explanation of that. Okay, generally what does instruction set do is, we'll be giving one operation. For example, you're performing arithmetic operations. So we'll be giving it an instruction set. Each instruction set performs different operations. So for one instruction set, we will be giving addition. And for another instruction set, we'll be giving subtraction. So if we, for arithmetic operation, if you are performing addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, we need 4 instruction sets, right? So if we want to perform n number of operations, we need n number of instruction sets, which is complex, okay? So we are reducing in this upcoming architectures. That is what this ARM processor do. And in V3M, this addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, we can perform signed and unsigned. I hope you guys know signed and unsigned, right? That is negative numbers or fractional numbers, anything we can do with this V3M architecture. This is an expanded version of V3. And then ARM processor V4. So in this V4, 26-bit addressing is no longer supported because here we are performing, I said instruction set, right? So in that instruction set, in this V4, we are creating a memory to store the instructions. For example, we are performing addition and we want to store that instruction. We are giving load or store instructions here. So it does only support 16-bit addressing and not 26-bit addressing are no longer supported. So expanded version of this is V40. What does V40 do is thumb mode. It's given as thumb mode, right? What it do is, it is an additional instruction set which does not occupy any memory. So I said, one instruction set performs an addition, subtraction, and each instruction set performs different operations. If we add this thumb mode instruction set, it acts as an additional one, which does not occupy any memory so that you can perform n number of operations in it. So even this thumb mode has a limit like 26-bit addressing, 32-bit addressing, etc. Okay. And then V5T. So it is an expanded version of V4T. And here you will be having executing instruction, clock instruction, etc. And in the V5TE, you will be having still more new signal processing instructions. Like you will be having digital signal processing. Hope you studied that subject already, I think so. Studied or not? DSP?
Yes, ma'am, studied.
Okay, fine. So here in this V5TE, we'll be implementing this digital signal processing. So previous architectures will not be implementing digital signal processing. So DSP plays a major role from architecture 5TE. Okay, and then in the architecture 5TE, we'll be providing the coding Java. So we can perform any coding operations with the processor like Java, Python, Perl, PHP, whichever you're convenient with, you can use. The first implementation is Java. And then V6. So in the V6, we can handle the data, which is if the data is, you know, unaligned or if the data is crumbled like a no manner, we can arrange the data and we can handle the data. Okay, that is that V6 do. And here V6 T2 thumb 2 instruction set is included. The previous thumb mode is 16 bit and here we use 32 bit thumb mode, which is the extra instruction set which does not occupy any memory. And architecture 7, it performs any artificial intelligence work. And in the previous architectures, we will be giving single instruction and single data. As I said, if you perform addition, only addition is given. And in V7 architecture, single instruction and multiple data. So in the single instruction, we are giving addition, multiplication, subtraction, and division. And we are getting the data for all the addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. This is what V7 architecture does. And here, performance versus capability. So classic ARM processors are called ARM processor. Whereas advanced ARM processor are called Cortex processor. These are used in embedded applications mainly. Okay, so Cortex family, see Cortex M0, M1, M3, M4, up to A15 we have. So this A7, AI, it represents the processor name. Okay, then mobile processor. So from this, I know you'll be quite interesting. We having mobile processors like Snapdragon, Exynos, then Bionic, MediaTek, etc. So Qualcomm Snapdragon, it's a basic mobile processor with the clock frequency of 1 GHz. So think about 1 GHz speed. It is little bit slow because emerging technology, we have 4.40 GHz speed of clock frequency. And then first, this Snapdragon was initiated by Windows, and then later it moved on to mobile processor. Okay, if the Snapdragon is added with this crate, you know, first of all, they added only Snapdragon, and then they added with the crate, then it performed even faster than the normal Snapdragon processor. So that is, initially it was 1 GHz speed, and then later on it is increased to 1.5 GHz. Clock frequency is nothing but it is just the speed of the processor, how fast your processor works. Okay, and this uses ARM8 A8 processor. As I said, ARM processor is the base for all processor in your mobile phones. And this is a simple structure of ARM processor, that is Snapdragon processor. See, you will be having n number of routers. So these all are composed to one processor and it is given a single chip in your mobile phone. So think about how efficient your mobile phone is, how easy to carry your mobile phone. So just think about it. And in the Qualcomm Snapdragon, we'll be having products like S1, S2, S3, and S4, and etc. So each are just enhancing one and another. So S2 is better than S1, S3 is better than S2, like that. So we'll be having n number of like this Snapdragon versions. And then, so coming to GPU, you know what GPU is, graphics processing unit, right? So previous years, we don't have this GPU in our mobile phone, right? Only processor, just a single processor does every operation, only we had that. And now with GPU performance, we can do anything in our mobile phones, right? So that GPU is called Adreno. The first version of GPU is Adreno 200. This was the first invented GPU actually. Okay, then it outperforms Hummingbird in 3D performance. Hummingbird is the processor used in Samsung. That is earlier version of Samsung mobile. They used Hummingbird. Okay, so this Adreno 200 just outperforms the Hummingbird. So Qualcomm combined with the GPU gives an efficient processor function. Okay, and then coming to Hummingbird, as I said, it's a Samsung first processor. Okay, now it has emerged to Exynos, Helio, like that. So first is Hummingbird, and it uses ARMv7. So this Hummingbird also uses the base of ARM structure. Okay, so what is the Samsung just 45 nanometer manufacturing tech? That is the size of the chip. Okay, 45 nanometer is the size of this chip. So single chip. So 45 nanometer, and now it is reduced to many 0.00 nanometer and all. Okay, fine. So with the ARM A8 chip, so it actually uses many number of modifications in Hummingbird compared to Snapdragon. Hummingbird uses number of modifications, like a many cores, it can be expandable. That is what this ARM 8 Cortex do. And then its performance is 1.2 gigahertz. So comparing to Snapdragon starting version, so it is greater, 0.2 gigahertz greater. Okay. Then its performance with 3D. So in the Hummingbird Samsung, we use a graphic unit called Radeon. So Radeon is more efficient than the Adreno at the start, earlier version, but now Adreno plays a major role. Okay. Now Cortex A9. So present mobile phones uses Cortex A9 to A15. Below that, we are not using it now. It's too rare. So Cortex A9 to A15. I showed you the graph, right? Cortex M0, M1, A9, A11. So at present, we are using A9 to A11. So what does it A9 to A11 do is, improves the performance and low power consumption, okay? And we have extra memory subsystem, that is cache. So what does cache do is, think about if your phone has 32 GB memory, okay? And your 32 GB memory is full, you have installed many apps, you have installed many apps and videos, and you're taking many photos, and 32 GB is occupied by that. But still you're installing your app, it keeps on installing. How is it possible? Because of the cache. This is then, you can call this extra memory in a mobile system. Okay, that is a virtual memory which will not be visible to you, but that virtual memory carries your extra information. That is more than 32 GB, it carries your extra information. Okay, that is what Cortex A9 do. And then here in the Cortex A5, you will be having a clock frequency more than that. You can have 1.5 gigahertz like that. So we are having cores in our mobile, like a quad core, octa core, etc. Quad core is 4 cores and octa core is 8 cores. What does this core do is, quad core is 4 core, right? So each core will be allocated with the clock frequency. For example, your mobile has a clock frequency of 2 gigahertz, right? So each core will be allocated with the 2 gigahertz, and each 2 gigahertz will perform separate functions in your mobile phones, like managing your apps, one core does perform that, and testing your apps, one core performs that, and installing the apps, one core performs that. So each core is allocated with the separate functionality in your mobile phones. Okay, if it is octa-core, still more efficient than the quad core. Okay, as I said, in the Cortex A9 also thumb-to instruction set encoding is done. That is 32-bit instruction set encoding, which is much more efficient than the 16-bit instruction set coding. Okay. So this is the Cortex A9 MP core architecture. So you will be having, see, many cache memories in here. So what are these cache memories do? I said already, it stores an extra, it acts as an extra memory to store your extra information. Okay. Okay, these are all some implementation. Where are the Cortex A9 implemented? Texas Instruments, Sony, Xilinx. Xilinx is a VLSI domain platform. So in that we can perform all processors functionalities. It is an interesting domain, Xilinx is. And here we go, one more graphical unit, NVIDIA Tegra. So initially it was introduced in mobile, and now we are using in laptops. NVIDIA, Helio, everything we use in laptop. So Tegra 1 and Tegra 2. Tegra 1, it acts as a basic image or video processor, whereas Tegra 2 acts as dual core image or video processor. This is the difference between Tegra 1 and Tegra 2. And this is the block diagram of Tegra 2. So whereas Tegra 2, see, it has image processor, audio processor, HD video decode processor, and then Cortex A9 processor. So we'll be having all of this. Whereas in Tegra 1, we will not be having 2D or 3D graphics processor. There's a difference between Tegra 1 and Tegra 2. Okay, so coming to the performance. So you will be having mobile phones with the front and back camera, right? So with the front and back camera, what are all the features you have? In the back camera, you'll be having monochromatic light thing, and then you'll be having sensors for each, if you're having quad cam. So quad cam, in that one will be monochromatic and the other three will be focusing, white balance, like that. So that is what's it here. So that is why your camera is given as the megapixel. So if it is 12 megapixel, the quality will be a little bit lower. If you have 64 MP or 128 MP, the quality will be very great as in DSLR camera. Okay. And then, okay, comparison with the other processors, NVIDIA Tegra Snapdragon. So if you see, the more it has is Apple iPhone. As you all know, Apple iPhone uses separate processor. It was tied up with the Intel for about 15 years, and then later it left because it said that it has its own processor to perform its own operation. So I need not need Intel to perform my operation. That's why after 15 years, they found one processor called Bionic and they implemented it, and currently it's going on so well. Okay, the state of multi-core processor, NVIDIA, as I said, it's a graphical unit, graphical processing unit. So it uses Tegra 2 chip. First, at the start of manufacturing, it uses Tegra 2 chip, okay, with a clock frequency of 1.3 gigahertz, okay? And this graphical unit has 3 quad cores. If it is called 3 quad cores, then 12 cores it has, okay? If it is called 2 quad cores, then it has 8 cores, okay? So each core performs each graphical unit, graphical processing, okay? The graphical processing, what I'm telling is image or video processing, okay? And then emerging Qualcomm, Texas Instruments, so like that. So in the Qualcomm, I actually said if the starting range is 1 gigahertz, and now it has extended up to 2.5 gigahertz, okay? And then Texas Instruments, and now we have a Texas like a 2.6 or 2.7 gigahertz, okay? And then Samsung. So Samsung is a basic mobile phone which uses Snapdragon, Exynos or MediaTek processors. So this Exynos come with the X series. Even you'll be knowing that Vivo X60. So this X60X represents Exynos processors, okay? So by studying this, you will be able to know more about the mobile phones coming now, because the emerging mobile phone has Vivo X60. So X represents Exynos. So you'll be knowing about the Exynos processor. Somebody has unmuted your mic. Please mute. Okay, fine. Okay, now coming to the battery life of your mobile phone. So your battery life depends on the processor you use in your mobile phone. For example, I'm taking Snapdragon as Snapdragon 720G and you have Snapdragon 865. So what is the difference between these two? What does G represent in the Snapdragon 720G? Is that gaming performance, which means if you are installing many gaming applications, like, you know, in the previous years we had PUBG, so like that and all. If you have the processor with the 720G or 780G, it performs more gaming operations and it will be more efficient and the battery will not heat. Or else, if you use Snapdragon 865 processor with the no G, that is, it does not provide efficient gaming applications. In that case, the battery gets heating. Okay, that is the difference between the G in the Snapdragon. Okay, so here NVIDIA uses Snapdragon to produce the gaming applications. Okay, so in the laptop, we are not using Snapdragon. In laptop, we use Intel. So in Intel with NVIDIA, we are providing many gaming applications. We can play many games in our laptop. And see, this is smartphone ranking, and now the current emerging first one is Apple A14 Bionic, then Snapdragon 888, Exynos, so like that, the everything. So it is shown in the graph. And the last is Snapdragon 768G. So now we have like Snapdragon 888, and the emerging technology will be Snapdragon 888G. So which does perform gaming operations, okay? This Dimensity comes under MediaTek, and Kirin also comes under MediaTek processor, which is used in Samsung mobile phones, okay? Then Apple design processor, we have series of Apple processors, like from A4, A5, A6, up to A14 Bionic, which is used in Apple iPhone 12 Pro Max, okay? This is the Bionic processor is used in present Apple iPhone. And then yes, series, T series, which are not in use now. This is the earlier versions of Apple. And this structure is the iPhone 12 Pro Max structure processor, that is Bionic processor, Apple a 14 bionic process structure. See, in single GPU, we have, I said, Tegra 3 quad core, but here we are having 4 GPU core. Then it contains many GPU cores, like, you know, 128, 512 GPU cores. So the Apple does perform many efficient operations. That's why it's in the top rank in the mobile series. Then about MediaTek. So in the MediaTek from 2003 to 2007, there is no GPU. See, no GPU is implemented. And if you see the clock frequency, it's only 52 megahertz. And what we now have is in gigahertz. So that is the evolution of the MediaTek. And from 2009 to 2012, here from no GPU and Power VR. What does Power VR do? Virtual reality. In the virtual reality, the graphic unit is installed. It does not occupy any memory, but it will not give clarity what we perform graphically. Okay. So see the clock frequency, it's only 650 megahertz. Later on, only it's developed to gigahertz range. So only if dual core is two core. So only two core performs in the 1 gigahertz clock cycle. And then later on, from 2013 and later, okay, see here also the ARM V7 is the base processor for MediaTek. Okay, and then hexa core, octa core, deca core. Deca core is a 10 core, hexa is 6 core. So like that it is developed. So at present we have till deca core. Okay, and here we use Mali GPU. We'll be studying it in later on session. Okay, if we compare MediaTek versus Snapdragon, which is better? Okay. So if we compare the processing thing, so MediaTek has average graphic performance, whereas Snapdragon is better than MediaTek, and battery life is longer in Snapdragon compared to MediaTek. So while comparing this, Snapdragon is the best one comparing to MediaTek. Okay, when we compare Snapdragon versus Bionic, Bionic is an Apple iPhone processor and Snapdragon is a normal Android processor. Okay, so what does it do? Why Bionic is more saleable nowadays? Because Bionic processor improves AI performance and it performs 11 trillions of operations per second comparing to Snapdragon 888 processor. That's why in the mobile chart, Bionic processor was the first one and Snapdragon 888 was the second one. And MediaTek versus Bionic, if you see here, CPU performance, this Helio G90T is the graphic unit of MediaTek processor. And see the performance in all these gaming performance, battery life, CPU performance, Bionic processor plays a major role. That is, Apple iPhone plays a major role. Okay. Because they are manufacturing their own processor with long lasting battery life, improved gaming performance, and improved CPU performance. Okay. And coming to Exynos, so Exynos also uses Mali GPU processor, that is graphics unit. So in the 2014-15, this Mali was introduced, as I said, in MediaTek. Okay, and coming to the clock frequency of this, in 2014-15, Exynos has around only 900 megahertz or something, and later on it is developed to 1.5 to 2 gigahertz. So only the clock cycles will differ for each processors. Okay, that is what Exynos. This is the current Exynos processor we have in Samsung mobile, Exynos 1080 and Exynos 2100. Okay, so the clock frequency now 2 gigahertz, 2.2 gigahertz. Fine. And the mobile phones which uses these processors, so for example, Qualcomm Snapdragon, it uses OnePlus, Realme, Oppo, Vivo. These phones use Snapdragon. These are Android versions, right? So these use Snapdragon. And Bionic, it's only applicable to Apple iPhone because they manufacture their own processor that is called Bionic processor. And then Exynos, as I said, Vivo X60 series. X represents Exynos series, okay? And then Samsung. In MediaTek, we have Samsung. So the starting of the Samsung manufacturing, Hummingbird comes into place, and then MediaTek takes the place, and then now Exynos. So like that, Samsung uses multiprocessors in its manufacturing, okay? And then Poco, which is a recent mobile, that also uses a MediaTek, okay? So coming to GPU, like it performs many graphical calculations. We are seeing like, see this image processing. So the earlier image processing was like this. I said the image processor, right? So that image processor just does this in a black and white version. Then with the reality, augmented reality, virtual reality, the process was enhanced. And then high dynamic range imaging was done with the Radeon Adreno processors used in mobile phones. Okay. That is why your camera has that much clarity. Fine. And then, what is this MP represents is megapixel. Okay. What your camera do is GPU. Okay. In the GPU, if that a megapixel was greater than 40 MP, 64 MP, your image processing will be done very efficiently and the output will be very effective. So 1080p, and now we got 4K, 16K quality and all. So even the YouTube, you can change the clarity like 1080p, 720p. That is pixels, okay? How many pixels? If you increase the pixels, your clarity will be too good. Okay, Mali 400 is done with 1080p. That is why we use most of the processors Mali 400, a graphical processing unit. And in high quality game content, here also comes Mali 400. So here we have per pixel. So each pixel was transized and each pixel has been mapped into further instructions. So this is the emergence of a Mali graphical processing unit, Mali 300, 200, then T604. Okay, this T604, what does it do? Well, see this image. There is an no anti-aliasing in this first image. What is anti-aliasing in this? There is flicker in the image, right? And then later on, it is developed to some blur image. And then later on in Mali 400, it is developed into perfect image. Then for game developers, as I said, you can use Mali 400 and then Tegra 2 system chip. Okay. Okay. This is a GeForce GPU architecture. See, here also it has many caches and we have pixel cache, right? What does this pixel cache do is, see, if your pixel is processing many times and if the memory is not sufficient, the cache memory occupies that pixel operations. Okay. Then a difference in using anisotropic filtering. What does this anisotropic filtering do is, see, the nearby image is visible perfectly, whereas the backward image you see, it's in blur. So when you use this filtering process, it has many operation and it has many equations, which we'll not be talking about now. So if we use this filtering process, the backward image is also visible very clearly. This was later on developed after Mali 200. So comparison of GPU processor, NVIDIA is the first one and PowerVR is the second one. Okay, this is the features of GPU. Less battery usage, sharp and vivid photos, and smooth DVD quality video playback. These are some features of GPU, why we use GPU. Okay. And 3D gaming. So 3D gaming, I want a trend. So it uses a Helio G30 in as of a Samsung mobile and Adreno 660, which is the current version. So for all these graphical processing unit performs 3D gaming. And then surrounding sound. We have an audio like 3D, 8D, 10D, 20D. Have you heard of that? Because it just increases sound quality. For example, I can say an app called Wink Music. You know that? Wink Music app? Anyone?
Yes,
Okay.
ma'am.
Okay, in that Wink Music, what you're hearing is 8D audio, right? So in that 8D audio, you'll be having much clarity of sound. Whereas normally we are hearing in Google Play Music or anything is 3D audio. Whereas what we hear in Wink Music is 8D audio, like the 10D, 20D are available, which increases the clarity of the sound. And then Vivid Photos, the starting pixel resolution is 10 MP, and then later on it is developed to 20, 30, then 40, 64, like that. Okay, GPU details. So initially the GPU's core speed was 270 megahertz. As of now, it is 2.2, 2.5 gigahertz. Okay, and then 128 bits, and it can be expandable to 512 bits like that. Okay. Okay, Power BI, which is not in use now, but just know about it. What does it do and why Power BI is less efficient than NVIDIA? So in NVIDIA, we are processing image, video encoding, everything. But in Power BI, we can't graphically edit the video. That is why NVIDIA is more efficient than Power BI. Okay. These are some series of Power BI, which is less efficient and less in use now. Some of the Power BI series, and this is the architecture of Power BI series. And see, here it's a pixel coprocessor. What is the difference between cache and coprocessor is, cache is a memory occupation, where coprocessor is, it does an operation, but it does not store any memory. That is the difference between cache and coprocessor. Then coming to Adreno graphics processing unit. Okay, as I said, it is used in Snapdragon and everything. And see the origination, 130, 200, 205, 220. And now we have 660. Adreno 660 is the present one. Okay, so see here, it has a 1.3 gigahertz clock frequency, Adreno 130. Then coming to 200, it has 1.5 gigahertz clock frequency. And then later on, 205, same 1.5, and then 220, that's all. So Adreno 660 has a clock frequency of 3 gigahertz. Okay, so that performs many graphical processing units in your mobile phone. Now you're having a task to do. Just take your mobile. Am I audible? Just take your mobile and just go to the settings. Are you doing, guys?
Yes, ma'am.
Just go to the settings and click about. In the about, you will be about phone. You will be having certain details of phone. In that, you will be finding RAM, phone storage, processor. So in that processor, what do you find? Anyone? In the settings, about phone, you'll be having some details of your phone. In the details, you will be having processor, right? Do you find it? Hello? Have you seen or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, what does it have? What processor it use? How much clock frequency it use? What's your mobile phone?
Octa-core max 2.2 gigahertz.
Yeah, so your clock frequency is 2.0 gigahertz. And click that processor one. And you have any CPU real-time data in that settings about phone? CPU real-time data. If you have, click that. Do you have it? Do you have CPU real-time data in the about phone?
No, ma'am.
No? Okay, fine. It's okay. So if you have the CPU real-time data, open that and see, your core will be divided. So if you're saying octa-core, it will be divided to core 1, core 2, core 3, core 4, core 5, 6, 7, and 8. So each core will be given frequency, okay, like 1 gigahertz, 1.25 gigahertz. That frequency will be changing because your apps are using that frequency. If you have CPU real-time data in that option, just click and see, it will be visible to you. Okay, these are all about mobile processors as of now. And then let's move on to the laptop and desktop processors now. Do you have any doubt in this mobile processor? Have you got any idea about what are the processes and how does it function in your mobile phone? Because it is not brief description. I'm just making you aware. What does the processor do in your mobile phone? Okay, no doubts. Shall we move on to laptop and desktop processors?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Okay, is this visible to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So your laptop processor is Intel, right? So the origination of Intel is 4004. And now we have not i7, we have up to i11. But only up to i7 is implemented in laptop, but i9 and i11 was it's available in a single processor, but it's not implemented in laptop. Till now, i7 is implemented in laptop. So we are going to see this evolution of 4004 to i7. Okay. So first, just know about this Intel company. So each year they produce one processor. So even in, if they are using i5, i7, so they enhance some things, enhance some processor things. That's why your laptop is asking for updates. If you update your laptop, the processor gets updated because they frequently update their process to perform some operations efficiently. That is why your laptop is asking to update daily. Okay. So coming to Intel 4004, it was introduced in 1971. So see the clock rate of it, 740 kilohertz, which is not even efficient. Okay. If you say, if you're sending an email to the person, you have to wait for at least 15 to 20 minutes to reach to that person. So it is very slow and it executes 60,000 instructions per second. It uses the same instruction set as used in the mobile phone. Okay. And then it contains only 16 registers, which is not even efficient. And it was not initially implemented in the laptop. Then Intel 4040. It is introduced in 1974. See, look at this images. It looks like a chip, integrated chip. So these chips cannot be implemented in laptop, but they used as a separate computer processor. Earlier, this was used in desktop, and now we are using in the laptop as an advanced versions, not these versions. So, and see, this is a clock speed of 500 to 740 kilohertz, which is very low. And then instruction set is increased to 60 instructions. That is, previously we had 60,000, and now we'll be having 60,060 instructions. Okay, and the number of transistors you see here 2300 and here 3000. Whereas in mobile phones we had 25,000, 30,000, but it is very low. Then Intel 8008. What does a 48 represent is? It's a bit. Okay, so if it is a 4004, it performs 4-bit processing operation, and if it's 8008, 8-bit instruction set. Okay. And here clock speed is very low, 500 kilohertz, and it executes 50,000 instructions only. The number of transistors is 3,500. Okay, and it is used in microcomputer, okay, which is not even in existence now. Then here, from clock speed is a little bit increased in Intel 8080, that is from kilohertz to megahertz, that is 2 megahertz. Here transistors uses 4,500. Okay, and it executes 500,000 instructions per second. Then Intel 8085. Then we have here 2 megahertz, and it is slightly increased to 3 megahertz. Okay, and the number of transistors used is 6,500. See, still now the transistor amount is not increasing, but what we saw in the mobile is fewer than 25,000, 30,000 transistors. But these things like 6,500, like in the thousands range. So it is not more efficient. These are used in simple projects in the earlier days. Then 8086, so slightly increased the clock speed with 4.77 to 10 megahertz. And then used in 2.5 MIPS. MIPS is called as an instruction set only. It is an advanced version of instruction set. Okay, and here we can see the increased number of transistors, 29,000 transistors. Okay, we are speaking about transistors here. What does a transistor do? it is just in a switching operation, in a switching operation of electronic signals, right? So that is what, if you are performing multiplication and one transistor performs switching operation for multiplication, and if we have like modulo division, division, like logical operations, so each transistor performs the switching operations for electronic signals. That is what transistor do. Okay, then Intel 8088. 5 to 10 megahertz of clock speed, then it is increased slightly. Then it is created a steepest version of Intel 8086. So 8086, you know, the microprocessor, right? So in the earlier days, processor and controller have been divided. Like, you know, the processor you have 8086, and then microcontroller you have 8051. So what is the difference between these two is, a processor does only one operation. So if you are saying to perform any operation, like, you know, if you are saying to perform any logical operation, if you're saying to perform an AND operation, it does perform only AND operation. One processor perform only AND operation. At the same case, if you're using 8051 microcontroller, what does it do? It can perform many operations. For example, you're saying that perform analog to digital conversion. Or perform any other operations like a bitwise operator operations, perform these. If you are giving an instructions to this, the controller can perform n number of operations. In the earlier days, these were the difference between processor and controller. Okay, and now within the processor, we can perform n number of operations. That is, we can have, for example, you're taking your mobile phone. Okay, generally, if you are working in any company, so currently I'm working in CTS or Accenture or any company, they're having the working model, like agile model and waterfall model. Okay, what does this model do is, if you're taking waterfall model and client is giving a project like manufacturing a mobile, okay, the client is giving manufacturing a mobile for me and test that mobile for me, okay. So the client is giving a project like this, and their developing team is developing a processor and a mobile for them, and then testing team is testing. So here the testing team plays a major role in it, whether the mobile is working or not, working in a good condition or not. So what this waterfall model will do is, the developing team will create an entire model and then give it to the testing team. Okay, in case in the testing team face any failure in that model, again, the developing team should recreate the whole model. That is what waterfall model will do. Whereas agile model, in agile model, if the mobile has components like, you know, screen, processor, battery, everything. So what the developer team will do is, they will manufacture separate things. Like, you know, first they'll develop processor for that mobile, and then they will give it to the testing team. And if any failure is there, the testing team will be giving it to the developing team. So the developing team can only change the processor's modifications, okay? They need not change the whole thing, because the agile model just works under parts, okay? The first processor will be tested, and then the battery will be tested, and then screen will be tested. Then finally, all the components, once the components were tested, then finally only the mobile will be tested. So now the company uses agile model only. So in that case, if you are testing the processor, okay, for example, you are testing the 8086 processor. So it is easy to find out what the fault is, because see, it is available as chip. Okay, it is available as pins, these pins. So if you imagine, if you're putting an entire model into it, it is difficult to recreate, and it is difficult to retest for this developing team and testing team. Okay, so the company uses mostly agile model and not waterfall model. Okay. Then emerging is 80186, 80188. And see, in each Intel evolution, we'll be having increasing clock speed, transistors, etc. And additional components also will be included. Okay, like clock generator. Okay, that is speed of the processor, then counters, interrupt controller. These are all you'll be having in your what are the things you studied in your 80086 and 80051? And the same thing will be having in this Intel processor. Then 80286. Same as clock speed increase and transistor increased, then 80386, 486, then Pentium. Okay, so coming to Pentium, slight increase in clock speed. The Intel's first Pentium processor was introduced in 1993. Okay, see here the transistor count is increased, that is around millions of transistor. So this was the first processor used in a laptop, not the previous versions. Pentium processor, the first version used in our laptop, and see in the laptop we'll be having virtual memory, okay, virtual memory of 64 terabyte. And then Intel Pentium Pro, that is the advanced version of Pentium, then Pentium 2, Pentium 3, like the Pentium 4. These are the Pentium versions of Intel, which is used in laptops earlier. Then Intel Atom, this was no longer in use than Pentium because of its small size processor and it goes more on heating. And the laptops got busted, so it was banned by the government. And then Intel Celeron, it does perform only small operations and it was not implemented in laptop. Then Intel Xeon, it was implemented in laptop and it has up to 16 cores. And you can see the clock speed of gigahertz. Okay, then Intel Pentium dual core. Okay, as I said dual core, it has two cores. Okay, then Intel Core 2 series, then Intel Core i3. So if you ask me like why Intel Core i3, i5, i7 and why not i2, i4, i6? Because Intel has already developed Core 2 series, Core 2 Duo. If they get as i2, i4, i6, the people will think that it's in a two-core processor. In i4, it's a quad-core processor. So in order to avoid that, they just named the series in odd, like i3, i5, i7. Even this i3 represents only dual-core processor, not three-core processor. Okay, you know, don't confuse it. So i3 has dual-core processor and i5, i7 have quad-core or octa-core processors, like, you know, a 4, 6, or 8 processors. Then 5, 7 does not depend on the number of processes, okay? And here you can see the increase in the number of clock cycle 1.2 to 3.7 gigahertz, okay? And here also you can see the increase the clock speed. And now we are using only i3, i5 and i7 processes in our laptop, okay? And we will be having increased the clock speed from evolution of the Intel core. Okay, and i7 is mostly used in the gaming laptop, whereas i5, if you use for gaming laptop, the laptop may be hang up for a year, okay, within a year. Then coming to Intel Core i9, as I said, it is not available, it is not implemented in laptop now, it is now available as a single processor or chip. See the clock frequency of it, 4 gigahertz, 5.20 gigahertz, okay. If it was in this gigahertz, our laptop performs n number of operations very fast. And Intel Core i11, so comparing to that, it has 5.3 gigahertz. The earlier version has 5 gigahertz, it has 5.3 gigahertz. And here also depends on the series of laptop processor, U series, H35 series, S series, like that, okay? Okay, in your laptop, you'll be having GPU and CPU separately. Whereas in your mobile phone, CPU and GPU are embedded together. In laptop, you'll be having separate cores for these two. So that in ASUS, you can, you might be having heard about of ASUS laptop, which performs many graphical operations. So it uses NVIDIA GPU. So that in all that laptops, we'll be having GPU separately and CPU in separate, okay? And then this LLC is logical link control. What does it do is, so these two performs separate operations in through the logical link control. It binds the GPU and CPU operations, and then it displays in a display control, a system agent. That is what we are seeing through the laptop. And some of the desktop processor, if Intel, it is called a laptop processor, and if it is AMD Ryzen, it is our desktop processor. And see the maximum frequency, as I said, the available maximum frequency is 4.40 gigahertz. That is used in Intel Core i9, okay? So the desktop has 4.2 gigahertz maximum frequency. So comparing to laptop, our desktop has maximum frequency. From this, we can infer that. Okay, so desktop processor, as I said, is a AMD Ryzen Threadripper. So this was the most powerful processor they've ever tested. Okay, so this processor has been used by a popular YouTuber. Like, you know, if you search H3 Productions, they use this processor, like Ryzen Threadripper. They have 4.5 million subscribers in the YouTube. You can search if you want. And then the longer Ryzen, it is more effectively deployed in the desktop, and it lasts for a more battery, and it offers 75% high processing performance, okay, comparing to the laptop. And these are consumer processors of desktop. Why I'm saying consumer is because in companies we'll be having business desktops, like, you know, for business they'll be allocating it. And in our home, if you're installing a PC, they'll be having consumer processors. So these are some consumer processors of desktop: AMD Ryzen Threadripper, and then Radeon with Radeon graphics, as I said. These are some of the consumer processors, and these two are business processors of desktop. Okay, these are mostly used in companies or in any industries like that. So these two processors are used in pro. If it comes as pro, then it is used in business. Okay, NVIDIA GoForce GPUs. As I said, NVIDIA is used in laptop nowadays. So these are the series of NVIDIA GoForce 4500, 4800, 5500. Okay. It is a multimedia graphic processor. As I said, it is a 4 quad core GPU, right? In that structure diagram I showed you, it's a 4 quad core GPU. It can decode video and audio formats compared to PowerVR, okay? And it has a 24-bit 64 voice sound processor, so that during the graphics, the video will not shuffle like that, okay? The modern trends of processor, as I said, the emerging technology, i3, i5, dual core are mostly sold in India. Okay. And as I said, Apple was first tied up with Intel. Then Apple just came out, and then Intel supplies most processors to Samsung, HP, Dell, and others. And now currently it's not in Apple. Okay. Coming to the conclusion, see, what we saw here is all our nano processors. The starting of Intel 80186, 80286 are called microprocessor, and what we have now is nano processors. Okay. Still, there are more processors to emerge. They are working on it. Still, i9, i11 is also not implemented in the laptop. They are working on it. So soon it will be implemented within a year or 2 years. So what I want you to do is just know about the current trends of processors, which is used in your mobile phones, laptops. See, if you are applying for a company like Intel or any Qualcomm companies, Qualcomm processor manufacturing companies, if you are very well versed in these processors, you will be hired and you will be given a salary of around 8 lakh per annum and 13 lakh per annum based on the positions. Like if you are a software engineer, your salary will be 8 lakh per annum. So knowing these things so deep, it's really good for you. If you are interested in this, please continue with it. Okay. I hope the session was interesting. If any doubts, you can ask me now. Okay. Thank you. Any doubts so far? Please do respond. Any doubts? No doubts?
No, ma'am.
Sure? Okay. So I'll be assigning you a task now. You should complete it within a week. What is it is, see, as I said, your mobile, you did one task now, right? In the settings, you have gone through about phone, and then you just searched to the processors and about CPU real-time data. So you should just do it in the Word. Like, you know, split it as mobile, laptop, and desktop. Okay. And just put it as in mobile, you just keep what are the processor and what is its clock speed and what is the CPU real time data. You just have to put that. And same for laptop and desktop. Okay. What mobile you are using, which laptop you are using, which desktop you are using, what is the processor, clock speed, everything you should mention and submit it to your faculty. Okay. Within a week. Will you do it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. So if any doubts, you can ask me or put it in the chat box. Is AMD best or Intel. Okay, coming to it's based on laptop and desktop. So in laptop we use Intel, but I prefer AMD because it is a desktop version and battery is longer life. But only disadvantage is it is not portable, like, you know, you can't take anywhere else. It is fixed in a particular area. So in that case, AMD is not best, but Intel is best. Any other questions? Now there is AMD laptops. Not so far. It is implemented in desktops, but AMD, the research was went, but then they dropped. Soon they will implement, I think so. But now they are implementing i9, i11 series only. AMD, the research was gone, but was dropped down. Any more questions? No more questions? You can please put it in the chat box.
Veda, are you in online? Veda, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Yeah, you have one more query in the chat box.
What?
Can you check in the chat box?
Yeah, I explained it actually, everything.
Okay. So, dear students, you have any other doubts? Okay. So, we'll go for a vote of thanks. On behalf of Electrical and Electronics Engineering, Sri Ramakrishna Institute of Technology, I thank Ms. Veda Swarubini for accepting our invitation in spite of our busy schedule. So you made this event more interesting. Also, I hope my students will submit your task. And yeah, I hope this would be very helpful for my students regarding their projects and also as well as for their placements. And also I thank all my students for showing their interest in participating. So once again, I thank everyone. And I request all the students to submit your feedback form I have posted in the chat box. So thank you, Veda.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Yeah, thank you, guys. Thank you. All the best.
So students, don't forget to submit your feedback form and also the task which is given by Veda. Submit the feedback form and then you can leave the meeting.